a great friend of mine that I met as a member of the World War II Memorial Committee, Dr. Helen Fagin, couldn't resist, I guess, my invitation to come up in the middle of winter from Florida. And thought she had missed the snow by a good margin, and just, she unfortunately missed it by about 6 hours. So she didn't get in. But Helen and I met, we worked together for many years on the World War II Memorial, which is now located, as you know, at the end of the Rainbow Pool, or at the former Rainbow Pool site at the end of the Reflecting Pool between the Washington Monument and Lincoln Memorial. Helen, I think, got become a member of this group because of her credentials. I readily admit that I became a member because I lobbied hard to get on it. But, you know, Helen is a former professor of English and director of Judaic Studies at the University of Miami, Florida. She was on the Museum Content Committee for the United States Holocaust Museum prior to the construction of the museum. She served for 5 years as chairman of the Education Committee of that institution, and was a member of its academic committee as well as its postdoctoral fellowship committee. She's on the executive board of the Florida Holocaust Museum, and she's founder of the Miami Beach Holocaust Memorial in Miami Beach, Florida. Of course, what brings Helen with us, to us tonight, is her experience as a Holocaust survivor. The Jackson Center is involved because of our guy, Robert H. Jackson, Supreme Court Justice, Chief American Prosecutor at Nuremberg. And I think it would be fair to say, without whose active involvement, many of the records of the Holocaust would have been lost. But Robert H. Jackson insisted that the trial be a trial based upon evidence, not based upon testimony of people telling stories on other people. So some 14,000 documents were entered into evidence, but many more were preserved at the trial. Jackson also had strong views that this was the worst crisis in human history, the war and the Holocaust. And as he said, the crimes have been so malignant and devastating that civilization cannot tolerate their being ignored because it cannot survive their being repeated. Jackson also believed strongly that there had to be an answer other than war. And of course, at the Nuremberg trial for the first time, individuals could be held personally responsible for their actions if they knew someone was innocent and they pulled the trigger. That was new at Nuremberg. And it was also the first time international law came into play in a trial of this type. Jackson said after, prior to going to Nuremberg, but after the agreement had been negotiated to have the trial, if we can root out of men's thinking the idea that all wars are legal, at last we will have mobilized the forces of law on the side of peace. We're going to listen to somebody tonight who went through the heart of it and survived the Holocaust. She won't talk a lot about her personal stuff, but hopefully enough so that you'll get a sense of what she went through. Today, when we interviewed her, Greg Peterson interviewed her, she had made a statement that she survived because of help, because of luck, because of happenstance. And I think that the fair to say she also survived because of courage, although she didn't say that. But put yourself in the position of a teenage girl being marched in columns of five towards the trains that are taking you, you know, to your death, and the woman next to her says, "We're not coming back." And this woman, this young girl, goes by an apartment building, and she knew the apartment building because one of her friends or family lived there. She jumped out of line, ran up to the top of the building, into the attic, found a coal bin, got inside it, and when the German stormtroopers came after her, they didn't go to the attic. They didn't know about the coal bin. That was the first time Helen survived, and there were many other stories like that before the war finally ended. But we are very fortunate to have Dr. Helen Fagin here tonight, and before she speaks to us, Greg Peterson has put together a short video that puts, I think, her life in the Warsaw Ghetto and in Poland and in other places into perspective.
Germany's Wehrmacht invades Poland from the west. 2 weeks later, Russia will strike Poland from the east. These crushing actions result from an infamous bargain, the Nazi-Soviet Pact, sealed by Hitler and Stalin less than a month before. This pact will last 22 months until Hitler breaks it in June 1941. Warsaw surrenders on September 27, 1939. The government goes into exile, fleeing to London. On September 28, another Nazi-Soviet pact divides Poland between Hitler and Stalin. The Germans keep Warsaw. For Hitler, this is a dress rehearsal for his conquest of Western Europe. Almost immediately, the Nazis crack down on the country's 3.5 million Jews. The Nazis revive the old idea of medieval ghettos, from which almost all of Poland's Jews are then gradually taken away, murdered, poison-gassed by the carload.
The Nazis regarded the Slavs and Jews as Untermensch, subhuman. Jews were ordered to live separately in ghettos and identify themselves by the Star of David. 17-year-old Mary Berg lived in the Warsaw ghetto.
July 31st, 1941. An old woman at a little table sells armbands of various qualities, from 50 groszy to 2 zlotys each. The cheapest are made of paper with a printed Star of David. The most expensive are of linen with a hand-embroidered star. These armbands are very much in demand in the ghetto because the Germans are very sensitive on this score. And when they notice a Jew wearing a crumpled or dirty armband, they beat him at once. A great number of almost naked children whose parents have died and who sit in rags on the streets. Their bodies are horribly emaciated. One can see the bones through the parchment like yellow skin. They no longer have a human appearance and are more like monkeys than children. They no longer beg for bread, but for death.
For what they called the Jewish problem, the Nazis decided upon the final solution: mass murder. In Warsaw, deportations began from the ghetto to the camps.
A few weeks ago, the Nazis began to round up the wives and children. Those who are not working are ruthlessly dragged away. Parents now take their children with them to their work or hide them in some home.
During the summer of 1942, 265,000 men, women, and children were taken from Warsaw to the death camp at Treblinka.
Senior Grade Jack H. Taylor, U.S. Navy, Hollywood, California. Believe it or not, October 44, I was the first Allied officer to drop into Austria. I was captured December 1st by the Gestapo, severely beaten, even though I was in uniform, severely beaten and considered as a non-prisoner of war. I was taken to Vienna prison, where I was held for 4 months. When the Russians neared Vienna, an extermination in Germany, where we have been starving and beaten and killed. Fortunately, my turn hadn't come.
There were... How many ways did they execute?
Five or six ways: by gas, by shooting, by beating, that is, beating with clubs, by exposure, that is, standing out in the snow naked for 48 hours and having cold water thrown on them in the middle of winter, starvation, dogs, and pushing over a 100-foot cliff. This is all true.
Which is very difficult to believe. Yes, I am a survivor of the Holocaust. I am a survivor of the Warsaw Ghetto and another ghetto of my hometown in Poland by the name of Radomsko. In that ghetto I spent 2.5 years until the time that my parents were taken away to Treblinka and perished there. My Holocaust experiences are many and very varied. And I don't know whether Raleigh is right or wrong, whether it took courage. But I think it took some creativity, maybe even a little intelligence, to be able to survive 5.5 years and live to tell the story. Greg Peterson interviewed me earlier today, and he asked me a question which I deferred till tonight. He asked me, how do I relate to being here at the Jackson Center and speak here? And I told him I won't tell him because I didn't want him to steal my thunder. I told him I will tell it to the audience. I also spoke today at noon to a group of wonderful teachers and other people, local people, who are interested in getting a message from the point of view of a teacher and educator. Because what I'm involved in, more than anything else, and more than even telling my personal story, is to make sure that I teach the lessons of the Holocaust. Holocaust has been over for 60 years, and we still are learning the lessons that that Holocaust taught us. And the lessons are simple. Hatred breeds violence, and violence leads to killing people and to murder. We are not born hating anybody. We are brainwashed, we are taught to hate. How much easier would it be to prevent that hatred? I'm always reminded by the writings of Anne Frank, who to the last woman said, she believes in the benign nature and the good nature of a human being. And yet, this is how any Wiesel likes to talk. And yet. And it is also Elie Wiesel who made the statement, who was the first one to make the statement. Those of us who are witnesses, we must bear witness not just for the dead, but also for the living. It is our obligation to the dead, 6 million Jews who gave their life on the altar of hatred called anti-Semitism. we have the obligation to remember why they suffered. And we have the responsibility to let the world know that we will do all that is impossible to prevent a similar event from happening. But we are not successful. Genocides are happening all over the world. We had Bosnia and Herzegovina, we had Rwanda, we had the Sudan. We know what is going on in the Middle East. People are killing people. We have to teach the lessons of the Holocaust so that our young people, who will be our future leaders, would not bring with them the potential of becoming perpetrators. You know, there were two elements in the Holocaust, three elements in the Holocaust. There were the perpetrators, there were the victims, and the bystanders. The perpetrators followed an ideologue. An ideologue who found fault with his country and blamed other people for the evil that happened or for the misfortunes that happened to his country. And the people he chose to blame it on were simply the strangers, the Jews. It was simple xenophobia. It was just making the stranger the scapegoat. But see, the German Jews didn't realize that Germany did not consider them Germans. Because to the fifth generation, they traced their Jewishness. And they suffered for it. Regardless of their contribution to the culture that was German, to the advances in science, in medicine, that Germany took credit for, suffered. They were taken to the Jewish philosopher of the 20th century, recently died, wrote a book entitled What is Man? And he sought a definition for the word man or woman. And he found that in order to describe a man, he would say, first of all, he's a human being. And he says the definition of that word, M-A-N, resides in these two words, in being human. And he said that dehumanization by a human being of another human being renders him inhuman. Another man, whom I recommend you read, Viktor Frankl, Man's Search for Meaning, a doctor of psychiatry who developed a new approach to psychiatry while spending time in Auschwitz. He called it logotherapy. A therapy, a self-therapy through thinking. And as he emerged from this experience, he said he came to one conclusion. That there are just two races of men in this world. And all people of all ethnic groups, of all religions and all nationalities belong to either of these two races. And these are a race of decent men and a race of indecent men. And my friends, that's all the division that exists in this world. If we don't learn to embrace our differences, if we don't learn to coexist with people who do have differences, then we are going to lead this world down the path of genocides. When Mr. Peterson had asked me about this venue, this center, I thought to myself, these pictures speak volumes. There were 21 defenders in the Nuremberg trials. Of thousands, perhaps tens of thousands, perpetrators who got away literally with murder. There is a very nice tale in Mr. Spinelli's book where the young boy Misha contemplates about the fact that when a child is smuggling some food through a hole in the ghetto wall, he gets punished. But a German soldier who may kill and abuse somebody goes home free. There is no justice. Robert H. Jackson represented that concept of justice. When I think of the Nuremberg trials, I cannot help but think of its anniversary, the 60th anniversary, which is forthcoming in November. And we just observed the 60th anniversary of liberation, from camps by Allied forces. And I cannot help but think that 10 years prior to the Nuremberg trials, there was another event in Nuremberg, the Nuremberg Laws in 1935. So the 10-year period between the Nuremberg Laws and the Nuremberg trial gave us the period which is called the Nazi period, which is called the Holocaust. And it is very, very interesting to note that both events are like bookends to the event of the Holocaust. The Nuremberg Laws were the prologue, and the Nuremberg Trials were the epilogue. And both had to do with law. And this gives us a little bit of a pause. How important laws are, how important lawmakers are, how important a legislative system is, because creating the laws leads to enforcing the laws. Enforcing bad laws creates a bad situation. The Nuremberg Laws were, as you know, very egregious, pernicious laws. And they were directed against Jews. They provided a new theory, a new division of a society into an Aryan and non-Aryan society. The construct of the word Aryan is not even German. It is based into Indo-European group of languages, and it is absolutely unrelated to a racist concept. Not even the Teutonic concept of early Germany, but it was accepted as a division. An Aryan specimen of a man is a tall, blonde, fair-skinned, blue-eyed man, and he is the model. He is the Obermensch. He is the Superman. Anybody who has a darker skin, slightly darker skin, brown hair, curly hair, and God forbid a so-called Jewish nose, is an Untermensch, a subhuman. They developed an entire science at the museum in Washington. We actually have the instruments by which they measured the size of the skull, the size of the nose. We have instruments that have different shades, colorings of hair and of eyes. And there were teams that would go from camp to camp, from community to community, making the decision who belongs to which group of people. Not only that, they extended the science to propagating more perfect specimen and to sterilizing those who should not be able to generate any more of their issues. This is a society that was thriving culturally, that was considered the most civilized society of all, most of all European countries, that provide us with a system that led to murder. This is a society that gave us people who had the highest degrees imaginable, who at that same time were capable, with all the knowledge that they possessed, to make the decisions which led to factories of death. There is a very pivotal point in the history of the Holocaust, and that is January 1942, the so-called Wannsee Conference, where 15 people, 15 leaders of the Nazi regime met in a villa, contemplating how best to annihilate, they call it exterminate, the Jewish people. They called it in German the Entlösung of, the Entlösung der Judenfrage, the final solution of the Jewish problem. Among them was Heydrich, Himmler, Eichmann, and others. The heads of Department of Transportation, Department of Education, Department of Industry, and their decision was that the best way to do it is to ask their scientists to develop a gas that will be very fast in eradicating people in the gas chambers. And once the bodies were gassed, in order to dispose of them quickly, they will have to build ovens to burn these bodies. I have a friend who survived Auschwitz. And in the last weeks of Auschwitz, were recruited to serve in a so-called Sonderkommando. Sonderkommando, Sonder means special commando, means group. These were people from among the prisoners who were selected to serve and to work in the gas chambers and in the ovens. And their term of service was 2 weeks. And after the 2 weeks, they themselves would be gassed and burned. This is a man who served in the Sonderkommando the last 2 weeks of the existence of Auschwitz. He came up to me once and he said, I must talk to you because I feel that I need to tell the world, but I am ashamed of myself. I cannot tell my wife even. He met a Canadian woman here, married her. I couldn't tell her because I hate to tell her that the hands that are touching her touched those bodies. And he looked at his hand and he was shaking nervously. These are the memories that some of the Jewish people who survived had to live with. Years ago, at liberation, I don't think that I could have ever, ever dared to contemplate prior to liberation in 1945 that I would reach the year 1950. And to think, and to be as presumptuous as to think that I would be standing here in 2005 and speak to you, the audience, and you will intently listen to me and want to hear these stories, I would say preposterous. First of all, America was a different planet, totally different world. It was out of my world. I came from a universe of death. How to return from that universe to a universe of life? Some people had asked me many times over, how did you feel being liberated? Well, I wasn't that overjoyed. It was a bittersweet feeling. I was left without parents, without home, without a country. I was talking to a liberator only in February. We had a big, big observance of liberation. We invited liberators. And by the way, Mr. Wroblewski, I like to pay my respects to you for having survived being a prisoner of war. When I spoke to liberators, they said, you know, one thing that struck us is that people didn't shout, didn't dance, didn't embrace each other. They just went limp. And all they wanted is some decent food and to be nursed back to health. Many of them, of whom suffered illnesses, typhoid and other infirmities. So liberation for me was bittersweet. And when I finally got from the Russian zone into the American zone, and got into an American displaced person's camp, those of us who were there started to contemplate our future. What kind of future was left for us? We haven't had a clue. But one thing we knew, those of us who came from Poland would not ever return to Poland. There was nothing to return to. And we have heard of an incident early in 1946 where some of the Holocaust survivors did return to a town of Kielce. There was a pogrom. They killed them. When many of the Holocaust survivors wanted to go back to Palestine, the English would not allow them to enter. And they created another concentration camp for them in Cyprus, behind barbed wire. And they let them stay there. It was a place and time where it was impossible to contemplate the future. By sheer luck, I was able to come to the United States. And it was a circumstance, totally unforeseen circumstance, that gave me this opportunity. And you know, I must share with you the feeling of coming from that universe of death to a new universe of life. I came here as a young woman without the knowledge of English, without any possessions. I came off a troop ship named Marine Fletcher on June 18th, 1946, without luggage, without baggage, without money, just my name. And I must tell you that after just short few years, I was being offered the American citizenship. Now you, those of you who were born here, are taking it for granted. But you know what it means to be offered life? Not just life, the right to life. Not just the right to life, but the inalienable right to life, to liberty, to freedom, and to pursuit of your individual happiness. It's an overwhelming concept. And yes, I did pursue my happiness. For me, education was happiness. But I also knew that leaving my experiences behind and leaving my world behind put upon me a grave obligation and responsibility, not just be satisfied with my own individual happiness, but to make sure that I share the consequences of that experience with others. So as a Holocaust survivor, I developed a mission in my life to get education and to be able to influence and inspire my students, young men and women, to make sure that they grow up preserving human integrity and acting with integrity and honesty, not ever having the potential of becoming a perpetrator nor a victim, but also not becoming a bystander. You know, an English philosopher, Edmund Burke, made a very poignant statement. The necessary thing for the existence of evil and for the triumph of evil is for good men to do nothing. Indifference is a sin of omission. Elie Wiesel once said that the opposite of love is not hate, but indifference. I want people to understand that every individual counts, that it is a responsibility of every one of us to make a difference, not just in our lives, but in lives of others, in lives of these young men and women who were impressed by the book by Mr. Spinelli. And I perused some of these essays, and some of them said it changed their lives. And I hope that they remember it, not just for now, but for the future. I think that that is so very important. It's the most important lesson you will ever learn. That you must be the kind of an individual that will leave a legacy for others, so that you will have made a difference. The kind of a difference that makes a student of mine call me not long ago, who has become a law professor at the State of Florida State University in Tallahassee. And she said to me, "Professor Fagin, I have good news for you. The school is sending me to South Africa. I am going to teach human rights at Cape Town University. And she said to me, if it weren't for you, I wouldn't have even known to be interested in human rights. This is my dividend. This is my payoff. When you wrote in your essays that Mr. Spinelli's book made a difference in you, this is his dividend. This is his payoff. And I hope that every one of you young people will grow up to understand that you have that obligation to do it to others. You may become leaders in your community, in your school, who knows, in the government. One of you girls may become the President of the United States. We had enough men. And if you do, the responsibility on your shoulder is to make sure that you deal with integrity. Ideologues are good if they are not fanatical. Fanaticism, whether it's political, whether it's religious, is an evil because it excludes others. If one is fanatical about one's religion, one does not accept another man's belief in his or her religion. If one is fanatical about certain laws, one limits the freedom of other people. We have to make sure that this is being carried on every level, in schools, in homes, and in churches and synagogues and in mosques. We cannot understand the culture. We Americans cannot understand the culture that provides young men and women to become suicide bombs and giving their own life because they were imbued with hatred of other people. In Iraq, every other day, there is a suicide bomber killing Iraqis, killing Americans. In Israel, there are Palestinian suicide bombers. Regardless what you believe in, we cannot tolerate the fact that we are wasting that youth for these purposes of manifestation of hate. Today I had a long interview with Mr. Peterson. I spoke during the time of lunch to the teachers. I had a radio interview. Jesus, the taskmaster had fun. I must tell you that I am proud and pleased to be here and to speak on behalf of the center, of the Robert H. Jackson Center. Because if I knew Robert H. Jackson, I would say, you are a man after my own concept of what a man should be. He knew that justice, even for the criminals, such as the Nazis were, must be meted out with dignity, with humanity, but with justice. That he had to leave the kind of a prestigious seat as he occupied on the Supreme Court, leave that for the sake of making sure that justice is served. I'm very proud that my friend Robert, Raleigh killer, I only mentioned Raleigh. Raleigh killer is involved in the center because I really truly believe that the center is a very important task and purpose in our society to make sure that the truth, the integrity is being disseminated among those people who would listen. So I'm appealing especially to you young people to remember the lessons of the Holocaust in any way that you can. Not just immediately after you read the book, but for life. For life. As for myself, I believe my favorite American poet said it best. Walt Whitman in Leaves of Grass, in Song of Myself, made a statement that I'll never forget because I made it my own. He said, "The pleasures of heaven are with me, and the pains of hell are with me. The first I graft and enlarge upon myself. The latter, the pain of hell, the pains of hell, I translate into a new language." I thank you very much.
Thank you very much. If there's anyone who has a question they'd like to ask Helen, she's agreed to take a couple of questions. We don't want to keep you longer than you want to stay, but if there's somebody who has something specific they'd like to ask Helen, I'd be pleased to recognize it right now.
Of course, what happened to him happened right after the war, and the Russians took care of him. So I had no occasion of meeting him at all. But we paid homage in Washington to Raoul Wallenberg, and we named our plaza, our address is 10 Wallenberg Plaza.
Thank you.
Robert, yes.
I was wondering if she would share with us her thoughts about Pope John Paul and his role in history.
During my radio interview today, the interviewer, the gentleman from the radio station, asked me the same question. And I told him that I thought that the airwaves were saturated with all the commentary that could be made about John Paul II, but I'll give you some personal insight into him. Karol Wojtyła, as he was known in Poland, was the Archbishop of Krakow. I have something in common with him, and that is we attended the same university, the University, Jagiellonian University of Krakow. Karol Wojtyła grew up in Poland. Karol grew up in Poland, and he was a witness to some of the persecution of his friends who happened to have been Jewish. And he maintained a friendship with one of his Jewish friends. So he saw firsthand what had happened, and he himself had suffered quite a bit as well. So he developed the kind of a sensitivity that unfortunately some of the other popes did not have, except for John 23rd, who was a wonderful human being who tried very, very hard to rescue a number of a number of Jews, which was not the case, of course, with Pope Pius XII, who reigned during the Holocaust, and for whom the matter of communism superseded the fact that it was Hitler who had the choice of killing or not killing the Jews, and he didn't intervene. But the present Pope, who is now the former Pope, the late Pope, had the sensitivity to apologize for the injustices that the Church has done throughout, not just the recent history, but the 2,000 years of persecution and anti-Semitism. It is very interesting that I decided, after I had offered my course in literature of the Holocaust, and I realized some of the baggage that my Christian students brought to the course. The questions that they asked me, well, isn't it true that Jews are guilty of deicide? And some other such questions. I decided to give a course on the roots of anti-Semitism as a prerequisite to the course on the Holocaust. And those of you who are learning from literature occasionally would find that some of the literature in your schools, very prestigious literature, offers you insight into those lies about Jews. One of them is the Prioress Tale in Canterbury Tales by Chaucer. Talks about ritual murder conducted by Jews on poor child Hugh of Lincoln. You know, when Shakespeare wrote The Merchant of Venice, he didn't have a model of a Jew in England, because Jews were expelled from England in the 12th century. He had to go to Italy to find a paradigm for his Sherlock, and wrote The Merchant of Venice. So we have a history of persecution going back over 2,000 years. When I was interviewed by the gentleman from the radio, he says, well, in all that you went through, did you lose hope? And I thought to myself, if it weren't for hope, the Jewish people would have suffered a demise a long time ago. The Jewish people have a national anthem, which is now the anthem of the State of Israel. But I remember singing that anthem when I was a young girl belonging to a Zionist organization. And the title of that anthem is Hatikva, which means hope. So hope is something we can never lose in the darkest, darkest moments of our lives, because there is always a glimmer of chance. If I had given up hope, I counted 9 times in my Holocaust experiences, I would not have survived. 9 times I was close to imminent death. And here I am.
Done yeoman's work today, and I don't want to overstay my welcome in terms of you being here, or however I'm supposed to say that. But anyway, you've worked hard for us today, and we thank you very, very much.